Good morning, everyone. We're going to get started here. Glad to see each and every one of y'all here. I'm Chairman Stan Jones, and I would like to welcome you to this March 2024 meeting of the Arkansas Game and Fish. We're happy to be here. We love this place and have got to get out and look at it and just see what y'all enjoy. And we're happy to be here, and you got a beautiful place, and we're enjoying this. I'm going to call this meeting to order at this time, and I'm going to ask we're going to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and we're going to have the prayer. I'm going to ask Chaplain Ted Darling to, where are you, Ted? Come up to the deal, and he's going to offer the prayer. After he offers the prayer, we're going to do the Pledge of Allegiance, and if you'd like to participate, that'd be great. Let's all stand.
Would you join me in prayer? Father, thank you for the blessings we enjoy, our freedoms, which we so often take for granted. We express our heartfelt thanks for these many years of your intervention into our history. We thank you for the natural resources and all that we enjoy beyond our freedoms. And then we come to a critical time in our history when we see so much happening that we don't understand and can't account for and see as a threat to many of these things. And even to our wildlife officers and to our game wardens, to the agency itself. So we lift them to you. We pray that you bless the employees, those who serve you as they serve this agency. And we pray your blessings upon this commission today, on the decisions. We pray for direction from you, and we'll give you the honor and the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This morning, before we get started, we want to introduce some guests that are here this morning. And I'd like to introduce Senator Terry Rice. And Terry, I ask you to come up and say a few words, Senator.
Thank you, and good morning. Good to be here at this beautiful place. Been a while since I've been to Mount Magazine. A little bit further than I remembered it coming up through Paris, but we made it here not but about 9 minutes late. Good to get to be with the commissioners, eat breakfast this morning. Lady and gentlemen, I thank you for your service. I know you take away from your personal life, your family life, your business life to serve, and we appreciate that. I'll go ahead and give my, plea. It's always good, I feel like, to not only give you concerns that I hear each and every day, but to let you know, I know it works from both sides. We've got an issue that is two-sided, and I'm guessing most of the people here about the dog issue today are probably from my district, which is Senate District 5. And there are people, I'm sure, on both sides of an issue that y'all have to deal with. So I have an appreciation for that. But what I would guess, without being a hunter anymore, I haven't hunted in many years. I couldn't now, getting out and walking like I used to, but I have two sons, one who is passionate about the dog hunting issue. The district that I serve has, at zone 11, has 8 of my 10 counties, all are parts of these counties. So this affects me and my constituents greatly. I would just ask for you to take in all of the information, judge it as fair as you can. I greatly appreciate Austin working with him. Not that I haven't had some good relations with others, but Austin is a breath of fresh air, especially for an attorney. But he does bring perspectives that I welcome. So again, thank you for your service. This issue, I'll be real short. Two men that made great impact on my life. One was my uncle, my dad's brother. My dad worked all the time. By the time I was a fourth of four kids, he was working all the time. He'd quit bird hunting. There wasn't any birds anymore. He didn't go fishing anymore. He worked like I do right now. But I've got a son that does this. And where he came from, getting it, my uncle, and ended up being another man, my father-in-law, are both been dead and gone for a while. They fought in some heavy fighting in World War II to defeat the Nazis. The one thing they both told me they wanted to do was get back home and run those dogs. And that was a passion. And I'll guarantee you, if they were still here today, they'd be sitting out here in the audience to be a voice for the future generation to have that right. We've got to find some kind of option that can be worked out that will be as fair as possible. As I mentioned to a couple of you, Scott County's 83% national forest. We're not going to change that. It's the most ideal place to work in and enjoy sports in of a lot of places in this state. And I would hope that we could find a way to have that available still for those who have the heritage of this sport. And again, respecting others' hunting rights. So I don't know if you meant for me to take my passion at the same time, but I only have to get up one time. I respect the place that y'all are in. I would just appreciate, you know, for you to look at both sides and find any way possible. I hope that some, I realize you can't, I mentioned Austin, in committee down there, we have to cut people off. We've only got so much time. But I always hope there's some spokesmen can articulate their thoughts. Mine just comes from passion because I'm not one of the hunters anymore. I just live with some and they're in my family. So thank y'all for inviting me.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you. I want to introduce Representative John Eubanks. Representative, would you like to say a few words?
My name's John Eubanks. I'm representative for District 46, which is right where we're standing. I've got all Logan County, South Franklin, part of Johnson, and part of Sebastian. I want to know who thought it was a good idea to give a legislator time to talk. So anyway, welcome to Mount Magazine in District 46. Thank you for being here, having the meeting here. I live at the base of this mountain in Greasy Valley. My boys have grown up on this mountain and hunted and fished this whole area. So I have a passion for the outdoors, although I don't hunt or fish much anymore. This part-time job that I ran for takes a lot more time than I thought. I would hope that the commission and Game and Fish would be cognizant of the responsibilities that they have in dealing with the public and try to build best relationships that we can, listen to their concerns. I've spoke with a couple of commissioners and the director on an issue, and I'm not going to go into that yet, but I would hope that as a government agency that you would be flexible and just be sensitive to issues and how they change and how science changes and how we can not only protect wildlife and our natural resources, but we can work together without too much confrontation and conflict. But I thank you for your service. I've been on a school board, and I know, and being in this job, I understand that you get a lot of complaints, and just like your game wardens and the people that work in the agency, you don't get much praise. But I think you guys really do a good job. I had the opportunity to go on a bear visit den and took my granddaughters this past Sunday down in the Senator's County, down in near Parks, and hearing the story about what we're doing with the bears in this state is, you know, a success story that I think we're doing it better than anybody else in the nation. So I think those are the things that we need to let the public know about, just, you know, all the good work that we actually do in this state. I remember when my boys were young, you'd be lucky to see a deer, you know, and now they're everywhere. And I used to have people drive by my farm just to see all the turkeys that were there, and, you know, they went away and now they're coming back. So, you know, wildlife is a great thing, and I don't know if people in our urban areas really understand the importance of hunters and fishermen and maintaining that resource that we have in this country. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative. I think we have Representative Matt Duffield. Matt, whereabouts are you at?
I'm here. I don't take up any more time. It's good to be here. And I echo what my fellow legislators said. So we look forward to working with you guys. Appreciate your service. Mm-hmm. Appreciate all you guys coming out today.
Thank you, Representative Duffield. Have some other people here that I want to introduce before we get started into the meat of our meeting. If I miscall your name, just let me know. We have the Logan County Sheriff here, Jason Massey. Jason, stand up. Who are you? There you are. Met Jason this morning and really impressed. You've got a good sheriff with very highly impressive credentials. Jason, it was good to talk to you this morning. We have Kyle and Heather Massengale. Where are y'all at, Kyle? Okay, right there. I bet Corey must be your son. Cohen? Okay, Cohen's going to speak here in just a little bit. All right, good deal. Ted Darling, the chaplain, who we've already introduced and said our prayer. Danny Hill, Perry County resident. Danny, where are you at?
I'm here.
Glad you're here. Michelle Lancaster. Listen, I forgot my glasses in my room, and I'm struggling through this. Oh, God. J.D., I'm not that blind. Michael Lancaster, yes. Jan Jones, president of Arkansas Dog Hunters, and Jan, going to ask you to speak here in just a minute. Glad to have you. We have some fox hunters and wolf hunters, and Josh Owens. Where you at, Josh? All right, glad to have you. Eric Sims, Eric. Harold Parsons, Harold. Travis Parsons. Barry Doerr, all right. And Ronnie and Kathy Powell. Now, you don't have a beard. The rest of these guys have got a pretty good beard. You don't have one. Greg and Troy Ains. All right, glad to have you. Hey, we're going to start off this morning with our first guest speaker is Cohen Massengale. Cohen, come up, and JJ is going to introduce you to everyone.
Good morning, y'all. Morning, commissioners, director. This morning we've got Cohen here. He is with the Ozark Schools, and y'all here to talk or to listen to him, not me, but he's one of the amazing success stories that we have with the programming and the offerings that Game and Fish Commission has for our schools and for our citizens. So without further ado, my man Cohen.
This is the first year I ever went to the Marksmanship Challenge, and I woke up that morning and killed a nice buck and then went and won first place. in my division. And this is the second year I went, and I won my first place in my division. This is when we went to the Big Squirrel Challenge, and we won our division and stuff. And these are just some pictures of me and my dog squirrel hunting, and the one is my first squirrel I ever got to kill. And this is when I got to go see the cubs and stuff in the den with my cousins, and I would love to do it again. This was last year in this year's duck season. We went this year to Lake Dardanelle WMA, and I got to kill a few ducks, and it was really fun. And me, my dad, and Alpa went to White Rock WMA, and I got to watch my Alpa kill a turkey, and then I killed my first Arkansas turkey, too. And we go to a beaver dam every year for my birthday. We've been doing it since I was 6 years old, and I love going down there and stuff, and I love seeing them stock the trout the 1 year, and it was really fun. And we live really close to the Arkansas River, so I get to go fishing down there and stuff, and I do virtual school, so I get to, my recess is fishing or hunting. And we went to Blue Mountain and I caught a big crappie, and then we went to the Ozark Dam and caught a bunch of white bass. And then the two deer are my first deer I've ever killed. And then the big buck is my biggest Arkansas deer I've ever killed. And we've been hunting it, and I finally got to shoot it. I got to shoot my first compound deer this year, and then I shot a really nice buck last year. I won the state archery, and I love doing it. I do a bunch of it. And I'd really like to thank everybody for coming and stuff and watching me. And I love the stuff that y'all do, and I'm glad that y'all do all the stuff.
Hey, Colin. Colin, hang on just a second. A couple questions. How old are you?
12.
12 years old? And so at what age did you get into this?
Six.
Six. What made you want to get into this?
My daddy and my grandpa.
My daddy and my grandpa? And so they're hunters, and they took you with them and showed them, and you liked what they showed you. Well, how has this changed your life a little bit? I mean, you look like headed in a direction this way that you like this?
It's just fun, and I just like it.
Okay, so what's your favorite things to hunt?
Everything.
Everything. Listen, there might be another question or two
I've got a question for you. Cohen, do you do a lot of chores around your house? You make your bed every morning? Let me tell you something. You might want to start doing a lot more chores, because you've got some really, really good parents and grandparents, and not everybody's as fortunate as you. So every morning, every chance you get to do something really nice for them, you should take that chance, because you've been given a great opportunity and you've done well with it. So I'm really proud of you.
Yeah, when I met Cohen this morning, first thing I asked him was, you remember this, right? First thing I said is, do you like hunting or fishing more? What was your answer?
I said it depends on the season.
That's right. This month he's worried about crappie fishing. Next month you're going to be worried about what?
Turkey.
That's right. So,
Colin, yeah. Have you ever skinned a deer?
A little bit.
Well, you need to get started. Daddy's not going to do this forever. And when you get to where you can skin a deer, you don't need your daddy. When you get to where you can skin a deer, you're well on your way. There's a lot to it. Shoot it, take care of it, gut it, drag it, get it home, tie it up. Then that's when the pulling the trigger is the easiest thing about deer hunting, pulling the trigger. The work begins after you pull the trigger. All right, we're glad to have you, proud of you.
Thank y'all.
The next person that I want to introduce is Paul Reams. And Paul, if you'll come up. Paul is our guest speaker today. Paul grew up in this area, and I contacted one of the local game wardens, and I said, can you give me somebody that has grown up in this area, that knows the area, that knows the people know him, and that he could come and tell us why. You know, when we come here, you know, we're not from this area, and we don't know a whole lot about it. We can look out at the mountains and beautiful. We can look at the lake and acknowledge how beautiful it is, but we want to be more embedded, more indoctrinated with your culture and your life here and why some people come to this area, why some people grow up here and don't want to leave. And the game wardens gave me this man right here. And so, Paul, I know you're president of the Turkeys Association in Paris and
yes, sir.
Vice president of the Arkansas NWTL. And so I'll turn it over to you, yes. And we look forward to hearing what you have to say about this great area.
Glad to be here. I'd like to thank all the AGF staff, commissioners, for letting me speak today. We talked about earlier out in the crowd, we were talking about, I'm gonna get this before I forget it. I represent the NWTF not only in a local chapter, but on the state chapter level. I see a lot of people in here that I have met before through NWTF. Luke Lewis, he's right there. I've been in many meetings with him. Jeremy Everts, that used to work for the Game and Fish. Jeremy Woods. I can name several. But conservation is one of the main goals that we have as an organization with the NWTF for this state. We participate with many other organizations, Quails Forever, the Game and Fish. We've bought land together to add more public hunting for people, just on and on and on. And I won't rant on that very long, but if it wasn't for the Game and Fish and these other organizations, if whether it's DU, Quails Forever, or whatever, we would not have what we have today in Arkansas. We would not have what we have today on Mount Magazine and the surrounding areas. This young man right here, you're one in a million, son. You really are. Kids like you, you are a poster child, I should say. There's not many kids can stand up in front of a crowd like this and say what you said and has been able to do what you've done. I'm proud of you. I spend a lot of time working with kids, first-time hunters. It doesn't have to be a kid. It can be a grown-up. I've taken mentally challenged kids hunting, and it's all through an organization that I've been able to do this. And everybody in this room is proud of you. Your mom, your dad. And I get kind of emotional when I talk about kids. But you're great. And thank you, mom and dad. I was here, brought here today to kind of talk about the mountain and why I'm still here. Well, that's one of the reasons. I'm able to do what I have a passion to do. My roots run deep in this area. My great Grandpa Corley. I live on Corley Mountain. But my great-grandpa Corley had a general store down there when that was, the community was a little bit bigger. We even had a post office at one time. My grandpa, Reams, back in the day, he cut mining timbers off of this mountain and hauled them to the mines when Paris had the big coal mines going on for mine, you know, sold them to the mining operation. My papa Hargrave, who also lived on this mountain or in Corley, he was the first constable in Paris during the coal mining days. He could tell you some stories. He was shot, he was stabbed, many things happened to that man, but he made it through it. My dad was a retired chief of police in Paris. I have a brother, Charlie Reams. He was a retired game warden. I don't know if any of you guys remember him. It's been a while since he was a game warden. He played a big inspiration in my life. My dad worked a lot. I followed him every step I could, but he had to work a lot. We was on had a cattle farm, poultry farm, plus he was chief of police in Paris. But my brother, before he was a game warden, when I was a little kid, I was in his shadow. I was with him when I killed my first deer. I was 12. I was with him when I killed my first turkey. Turkeys were abundant back then. And a little short story, I thought turkey hunting was stupid. Just put it blank, I thought it was stupid. Why would you want to go out there and chase a bird? Well, he finally talked me into going, and I've been going ever since. So, but anyway, I also like to thank the game wardens that's here. I'm friends with those, Ben, and you guys are great. Jason, I'm proud to know y'all. But I was born in 1963 down in the old Paris Hospital. I've lived here every day since then. I probably know the south side of this mountain, or the north side of this mountain, as good as anybody. Rich Mountain, Calico, all that. This area has so much to offer and has been given so much. Why would you leave? There's so many places you can go and fish. You can hunt. There's, like, I believe, 110,000 acres in this WMA, the Mount Magazine WMA, that is open to the public. You can hunt, you can fish, you can hike, there's ATV trails. The schools, the surrounding cities are great. I know Boonville and Paris are, we're butting heads all the time, but we still live in the same county, and we still share this mountain and the surrounding areas. Mount Magazine WMA has around 275, I think, food plots that was put in for the public to use, not only just for the wildlife, but you can, people hunt those. It's pretty easy for somebody that has a disability or whatever to get to those and be able to hunt and enjoy without, sitting at home saying I can't go anymore. But you can leave this area. You can go to Russellville. You can go to Fort Smith. You can go to Northwest Arkansas within an hour or two from this area. But there's so many things to offer here that, there's no reason to leave. That's my opinion. I was very fortunate to have a family that grew up hunting and fishing. I mentioned my grandpa cutting the mining timbers. My grandma always told me that part of the way they paid for their place was he coon hunted. I grew up coon hunting. We coon hunted back when the hides, when you could get, were worth something, and now, that has come to a halt. You hardly ever, over here anyway, see anybody that hunts coons. I'm gonna step in on another little bit of conservation effort. I would like to see, if you own land in this area, the Game and Fish has a thing going on that if you own your land, you can trap basically year-round. I know a lot of people don't like traps. I don't like traps, but I like the dog-proof traps. We all know there's a turkey, and again, I'm speaking through the NWTF, has enemies everywhere they go. Everything's trying to eat a turkey or their eggs. But the Game and Fish has this offer, and you can get it online. It doesn't cost you anything, to where you can trap varmints, coons, possums, nest raiders is what I call them. We need to push that. The wild turkey has come back this year probably better than it ever has in the past. I've seen it at its best, and I've seen it at its worst. It's sad when you have to go for days and not hear a turkey, and when you do, there's 50 other people chasing it. So, you know, the wild turkey needs your help. And I think there is somebody here today that Stan told me about that is gonna be here for us, that's a speaker, he's in the audience, that would help get you hooked up. The local game wardens can tell you how to do that. But you can take a dog-proof trap, you won't have to worry about catching a dog, and you can get rid of them. Help the turkey population. Again, I'd like to thank everybody. I think I've said enough. It's been an honor to be here. Luke, I'm glad I got to see you today. Luke's gonna be leaving us. I don't like that, but people come and go. Again, the game wardens, appreciate what all y'all do. The sheriff, glad to see you here. John Eubanks. We were neighbors for a while, several years. So anyway, it's about all I have to say, but thank y'all.
Thank you, Paul. Paul, hold on. Paul, hold on a second. Garrett Duggar, would you stand up? This is the guy that's over our private lands, Paul. I just want you to see him, and y'all may want to talk after the meeting or something, but you talk about some things that you would like to see and done a little bit. Garrett could probably answer, assist, help you, but that's our private lands. Anybody have any questions up here for Paul? All right, thank you, Paul. Thank you very much. Hey, in just a second, I'm gonna ask Jan Jones, president of the Arkansas Dog Hunters Association, to come up and speak and say a few words. Before she does, I wanna introduce three important ladies that's here. Beth Neely is here, Sherry Jones is here, and Jan Zimmerman is here. And there you are, you hid. I wanna make sure I introduce y'all. Glad y'all have come a long ways to be here. And Jan Jones, would you wanna speak at this time? Say a few words.
First of all, thanks for letting me speak and for everyone for coming today. Thank you for your supporting us and for all the work you do. I know that it's very hard. With Arkansas Dog Hunters Association, our mission is to unite everyone that hunts with dogs, whether it's squirrel, deer, coyotes, coons, and to protect the heritage. Hunting with dogs has been going on since the 1800s. And we don't want to see that stop. One of my passion is the youth. If you go to any field trials, you deer camps, family traditions, you're going to see a lot of youth. And my concern with this proposal, is this high enough? Is that some of the average families, a collar and a system is going to be approximately $1,000 and more. So you've got some here that's on fixed incomes. You've got some youth, and they simply can't afford that. This year, our youth hunters, my understanding, the stats, they have declined. And we're working hard, actually, to get those built back up. We've got a youth board. We love to take hunters out, the youth and the elderly that can't go, or maybe they don't have dogs anymore and they just want to go. And that's one of the things that we strive to, to promote and to protect. So we just want to ask that you seriously consider that from a financial standpoint.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Just a short speech. Thanks.
No, that's great. Hey, go ahead, Rob.
No, listen. We certainly feel the challenge with what's laid out before us. And I'd have to ask you the same question, and not rhetorical, but not necessarily answered today, but something to consider is you know, what is a viable option to make both sides work? I mean, we're approached by folks who own land, who spent a lot of money for their land, put quite a bit of money in their habitat, and while sitting on their deer stand on their land, dogs run through them and completely ruin their hunt. So again, we're passionate, and we're certainly concerned for both sides. But as a governed body of this, we're trying to find what works for both sides. And we hear what you're saying, and we understand that. And we certainly don't want dog hunting to go away. But we're trying to find something that would appease both sides. So we would love to hear some reasonable alternatives from your sides, from the folks on the dog hunting side, as to what we can consider that works for the other side.
First thing I want to ask is, due to the stats that we looked at, you had approximately 22 complaints last year, which is a little less than the year before. So I'm not sure that's a problem. The other thing, deers are creatures of habits, and they circle back through. So you've got deer, they're laying maybe in a draw, they're laying somewhere, they're not up and moving. When you put the dogs in, they're actually going to get the deers up, and they're going to make them move. So they, at that point, hunters, the seal hunters may see more that way. Just a point.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have some fox and wolf hunters here. I extend an invitation. Do one of y'all want to stand up and speak? You know, there's several of you here. Do one of y'all want to stand up and speak?
Hello.
Come forward, please. And what is your name?
My name is Ronnie Powell. I'm president of the Scott County Fox Hunter Association, vice president of the Arkansas State Fox Hunters. I'm a past president of the National Junior Fox Hunters. And that is something that I've been in all my life. I was raised by, my dad was a fox hunter and a houndsman, and that's the way he taught me to hunt. And I didn't take up still hunting until I was older, but I have great passion for the youth in this sport. But appreciate everything the Game of Fish. You know, y'all got a tough job ahead of you, I can see, with the problems that's going on with the out-of-state hunters coming in and stuff. I hope we can find a solution to that. My intention is to get familiar with y'all, and y'all get familiar with me, and try to be a voice for the fox hunters that if you need input or whatever, be glad to step in there and do what I can. But this is a passion of mine. That is, it's a sport, but it's a heritage too that I love very much, and hope that we get to keep that right. Thank you all for having us here.
Thank you very much. What Commissioner Finley was saying is kind of worth just talking about just a second. I've hunted behind dogs when I was young, so I absolutely know what this is. You know, I think when we see pictures in the paper, like we saw this past year, where 69 deer was piled up on a trailer, people come from out of state and come in and take 69 deer and put on a trailer, you know, that's hard to understand. It's real hard to understand. You know, for people that's been here before and talked to us, and they have private land, they put food plots, they've got a buck, they've been watching for a year or two and didn't shoot it, and they're out there and dogs come through and run that buck into another county. Listen, there's two sides. There's very much two sides to this, which side of that you're on. What we hope to do, what every one of us up here are compassionate and passionate about this, but what we hope to do is find some kind of a solution that we can work with this. We absolutely don't want to take away what you've done your whole life or what you teach your kids to do. We don't. But by the other token, these other people that own private land, you know, they have some privacy as well. So we're going to look at that really hard. And Senator, with what you and Representative said, we hear you. We hear you real well. Thank y'all, and thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. And it's important that you come and that we're able to see your passion and be a part of this. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My name's Randy Jones. I'm from Central Arkansas, and I've hunted all over the state of Arkansas, coyote hunting. We go to different states. And what I want to say, the hunting is, it goes deeper than the hunt. For me, I grew up in a town where drugs were running rampant. And if it wasn't for fox hunting, being able to go out in the mountains and turn my dogs loose, I would probably be one of those statistics sitting down there in the prison. So it's real passionate to me about keeping this going because I know where it can lead. I've seen some of my best friends, they're down there locked up because they chose to hang out in the parking lots instead of go out in the mountains and listen to dogs run. As far as the hunting aspect, what I've seen personally, we've extended our bow season so long, when you start co-mingling dog runners versus bow hunters, there's an issue there. I'm a bow hunter. I understand it. I try my best not to even hunt during bow season. But the bow season has been extended so long, and it causes conflict. There's a lot of people that's not gonna wait like I do. And that's something maybe we can look at, is shortening the bow season to, you know, giving them 3 weeks, muzzleloading them 2 or 3 weeks, and guns that, you know, keep them equal instead of 6 months for bow hunters. That could help, because it's frustrating to go put in all the work as a bow hunter, climb up in your tree, and you're expecting this big buck to walk out, and you hear a pack of dogs come through there, run your deer off. Well, I know from experience, those dogs didn't run the deer I'm hunting off. They brought it in there, they took it out. But a lot of people don't understand that. The deer they're hunting may have got up and moved 10 feet and laid right back down. And that's the kind of stuff that people that don't hunt with dogs or haven't hunted with dogs don't know. I've also come in and jumped a deer 5 days in a row with the same deer out of the same spot. And as soon as those dogs quit pursuing that deer, you can set on that same line that deer took going out of there, and most of the time you can see that deer coming back. It's just not understanding all the facts of how to hunt is. I guess that's all I guess. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Guys, at this time, we're going to move into our meeting. I need approval. First matters, I need approval for today's agenda. Are there any deletions of the agenda as presented? If not, have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye. Any opposed? The motion is approved. I also need approval of the official commission meeting notes from February the 15th to 24. Are there any additions or deletions to this? Can I have a motion?
Salute.
Is there a second?
Salute.
All in favor?
Aye.
The motion is approved. At this time, staff presentations. And the very first one up is our bear guy, Myron Means. You're not Myron.
Got too much hair for Myron.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Director Booth. I'm my privilege this morning to introduce my colleague here, Myron Means, who's been with us for 27 years as our bear biologist, probably the one of the most charismatic species in our agency. And he uses that to his advantage to get his POs taken care of. So Myron's going to give us a report this morning on the status of the black bear here in Arkansas. And appreciate you being here this morning, Myron.
Thank you, Luke. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Director, members of the audience. Thanks for having me here today. You know, I have a lot of platforms, different platforms that I get to kind of tell the bear story, whether it's podcasts, whether it's den visits, whether it's radio shows or black bear bonanza or whatever. But I'll tell you what, after being involved with bears in Arkansas for 3 decades, I never get tired of telling the story about Arkansas black bear. And when you put it in perspective, you know, the black bear conservation program in Arkansas is only 60 years old. 60 years old. And it is a flagship conservation story for not only Arkansas, but every other conservation agency around the country that has bears. So this year it was 43rd consecutive bear season that we had in the state. And without further ado, let's talk about the bear harvest. Pointing it at you. There we go. This year we had the same number of bear zones that came into play as last year. Last year, zone 4 and 3 and 4 were added in the Gulf Coastal Plain. We still have a bear season around roughly 4/5 of the state. This past year was a record harvest year. 765 bears harvested this past year, which eclipsed the previous harvest record year in 2020. By 100 bears. And I will tell you that is most likely solely attributed to the early opener that we have kind of moved toward the last couple of years. And quite frankly, we are finally getting bear harvest in the state about where we need bear harvest in the state. So it's been a great year. It was a great year. The harvest by sex and date, as you can see, the one trade-off to the early opener is the elevated female harvest rates. And we can look back through time for the past 40-some-odd years whenever we've had early opener dates. What happens is female harvest rates will go up. The earlier you harvest bears, it's kind of standard, the more females you will harvest in the season. So 48% female harvest rates, 52% male harvest rates. And as if you look from September 13th, you can kind of follow along the days, and long about muzzleload season, you'll see another little bump in harvest. And then long about gun season, you'll see another little bump in harvest. But it's pretty easy to tell by the graph where and when most of the bears are being harvested, males and females alike. To give you an idea of the rundown county-wise about harvest rates, as you can see in Bear Zone 1, it's basically the National Forest core counties. Same thing for Bear Zone 2, the Ouachita core counties, Ouachita National Forest. And then, of course, Bear Zone 4, you can see it's really kind of centered around that Bradley, Ashley, Union County, Felsenthal group, and then you have another patch up around Dallas County. There's a lot of information on this slide, but there's a couple of take-home, points from this slide. Bear Zone 1, obviously, it's always the zone leader. And bear harvest, it has been ever since we've had Bear Zone 1 and 2. Zone 1 is always the leader, with 60% of the bears being harvested in Bear Zone 1. And if you look at the yellow or the ochre color archery harvest, for Bear Zone 1 and Bear Zone 2, archery harvest is always the leader. And I'll go into a little bit more detail on that later. But the the main thing to kind of keep in mind is that Bear Zone 1 is always the leader, and it has to do with the private land distribution across the Bear Zone as compared to the Washitas, which is kind of a holistic block of national forest with not a lot of private land interspersed. So that's why Zone 2 tends to be self-regulating in harvest rates. There's not a lot of private land to bait on within the national forest, whereas Zone 1, there's private land scattered all through the national forest, which makes those national forest bears or that core population more susceptible to being harvested over bait. That's why Bear Zone 1 has a quota and Bear Zone 2 does not. Oh, let me back up there. I missed it over on the side. Another key point, if you'll look over in the pie chart, 84% of the bears harvested in the state last year were harvested with archery tackle. So if you're gonna set harvest strategies to either improve or decrease harvest rates, guess how you're gonna do it during the archery season. This wasn't a fluke year. Typically any given year, 75 to 85% of the bears harvested is gonna be with archery tackle. That's what governs our season success or failure, is the archery harvest. Bear Zone 1, 453 total. Of course, if you look at archery, 52% males, 48% females across the zone during the season. And I went ahead and put in for the last 10 years, I wanted to kind of graph male-female harvest rates. And there's a point I'm going to get to by the end of it. But if you look at the male harvest rates in blue, the blue columns, the female in the red, you can see that every year male harvest rates are higher than females, except for this past year, which is what we want. That's what you want to see. It's kind of the middle of the graph. You always want to see higher male harvest rates than females with bears.
Dave Mauer?
Yes.
In Bear Zone 1, how many of the 400 and, was it 453?
Yeah. Yes.
How many of the 453 in Bear Zone 1 was harvested the first 10 days of bear season?
Well, probably about 408, okay. Or let's say about 400. I mean, any given year, that first 10 days of the archery season, that's when it happens. You know, I'd say 90% of the archery bears killed in Bear Zone 1 were harvested in that first 10 days. Well, this year, the quotas met in 7 days. So, I mean, that's the bulk of your harvest rate in that first few days. Same thing for Zone 2. This archery over here, the 233 out of the 282 bears harvested with archery tackle, virtually all, well, Zone 2 is a lot more spread out, so I won't say in the first 7 days, but definitely within the first couple of weeks of the archery season. And as you can see over on the far right, again, I grafted male and female harvest rates for the past decade or so for Bear Zone 2, just to kind of give you an idea. There were some years back in the early 2010, 11, 12, we did some things adjusting the season earlier in the Washitas and Zone 2, and that kind of explains why that female and male harvest rates are so tight or so close. But as you can see in the normal years after that, when the season was a little bit later, that's when you start harvesting more bears. Bear Zone 4, well, there's only a couple of years of data, so it's a quick one. Last year, 2022, we harvested 14 females and 14 males. There's a 25 bear quota in Bear Zone 3 and 4. This year, we had a little bit of technical difficulty, so we didn't get to finish out the season. It was closed a little bit early, but we still harvested 19 out of the 25. And a much better harvest rate this year, males compared to females. But as you can see, 63% male, 37% females. And Bear Zone 5 and 5A, because harvest is really so low, I just kind of grouped them both. And really, Zone 5 and 5A, I mean, historically, you know, male and female harvest rates is just kind of all over the map. There's not a whole lot to decipher from that. But female harvest rates this past year were 73%. 27% males, and you know, 1 year it may be a complete inverse of that. And to kind of get, yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, this past year it was the second weekend in December, and it, you know, it's kind of hard to say with 2 years. I think pushing it back to the third week in December, I think that will help. You know, I think it's going to be a magic bullet that every year we're going to end up with 65% male harvest rates and 45, I don't really know. I do know there's obviously still females on the landscape then, because of our collar study. You know, a lot of those females, even the pregnant ones, aren't locking down until maybe some of them the end of December. You know, obviously the males are still going to be on the landscape, because in the Gulf Coastal Plain, they really don't have much of a denning cycle. I mean, they're on the landscape in December, January, February. They have no reason to go into a den cycle.
Are you still seeing the population growth
there? Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, what we saw last year doing the reproductive surveys and this year, I mean, the average litter size in the mountain zones is 2 cubs per adult female every other year. In the Gulf Coastal Plain, it's going to be a lot higher than that. It's probably going to be more like 2.5 or 2.6 cubs per litter. I mean, it's what I would expect: lower densities, great habitat, and a growing population. So I would expect those elevated reproductive rates to persist for a while. to give you kind of an idea of how our age class distributes through the harvest years, I took the last 3 years, and you know, in any given year you could pick up in the last 20 or 30 years and it's probably going to look about like this, especially since 2001 when baiting has been allowed. But you know, most of the bears are, of course, what, 6 years and younger. That's going to be the majority of the bears, especially with baiting. You know, a lot of times you get the subadult males or females that, you know, don't really know better, and they're going to be more susceptible to harvest. One of the things that is kind of, I wouldn't say concerning, but something to take note of as a biologist, is if you look in the middle of the graph, that 6 to 12 year range, higher females, especially like in 21, you know, that's the breeding stock. Anything from, you know, that 6-year-old to 15-year-old, those are the prime breeders. So anyway, it's just kind of give you a ballpark or give you an idea of how the age class distributes out over the harvest. And so a couple of discussion points, I guess, looking back at this year's harvest rates and kind of where we've been. It's the highest harvest on record. As I said, it's a clear benefit of the earlier opener. I have no doubt in my mind that the early opener is the way to go for the foreseeable future. However, with that higher harvest rate comes maybe a little bit more diligence about managing that higher harvest rate. And, you know, having a 48% female harvest rate is not the most favorable harvest rate. Usually in the bear world, anything above 45, 46% is just not a good place to be when you're harvesting bears. Now, I'm not going to say Chicken Little, the sky's falling, because we had 1 year of 48%. Next year may look totally different, depending on what the mass crop is. But, you know, consecutive years of elevated female harvest rates above 45% would require some type of mitigation for that. So, any other questions?
Myron, you had a slide probably in your first 10 that showed the gender breakdown of harvest based on the timeline of the 23 season.
Yes. Let me get back. It's right. Nope. Did I pass it already?
I think it was earlier.
I'm going back. Are you doing that, or am I doing that?
Yeah,
go back.
What slide is it?
Back. Right there.
That one right there. All right. So September 13th.
Yep.
That was the opener, correct?
Yes.
All right. So we see female harvest south of 70 right there, and male harvest what looks like north of 80, right?
Correct.
To me, that's a great news story. Because, you know, we've been trying to educate our bear hunters that are not, you know, bear hunting because they're taking one incidental to deer season, but because they are out there on purpose, deliberately pursuing a bear. Then, as we get further on beyond that opener, you know, then I think what I see there, and correct me if I'm wrong, but we get into archery season and we see more incidental take going on. So from an education perspective, how do we educate people on not only the male, female, and how you identify that boar versus sow, but also the age class?
Yeah, we have, I produced a video last year with Clay Newcomb and Bear Grease about how to field identify, you know, male versus female, young versus old. And Clay has been a real advocate of it. And, you know, we've tried to convey that message to the hunters. And, you know, it may simply be mitigating female harvest going forward. It may just be something that can be done with a good education campaign, a little bit more vigorous education campaign. I would hope that it would be. But I think you're right. I think some of the stuff that may be going on, remember zone one is the heaviest harvested zone. I think some of the things that may be going on is as that gets closer and closer to that quota cutoff, you know, you may be seeing people get a little bit antsy about it. Well, I definitely want to harvest a bear this year, you know, so, you know, it's kind of a last minute. Maybe they don't necessarily want to take a female, but they might, you know, if it's the last day, it was probably going to close tomorrow. So, I mean, I can understand all that, but certainly, you know, an education campaign going forward and see how that mitigates the harvest rates going forward. But, you know, I mean, next year may be it opens September, or this year, that it opens September 18th this year. And, you know, it's a flip of the coin as to what the mass crop is going to be doing by September 18th. And so that'll be a big telltale sign there. So, yeah, we'll see kind of where it goes. Like I said, I don't want to come across as, you know, Chicken Little, the sky's falling because we harvested 48% female. But just understand in the bear world, 48% over the long term just really isn't sustainable.
So you know, lightly touched on it, but how, for the public, how do you distinguish a male and a female with there's no cubs and, you know, say both of them are full size?
It really has to do with general anatomy. And I tell people all the time, male bears are built for fighting, which means they have big chest, big necks, big thick necks with muscles, big arms, big forearms, and wide wrists and big paws. They're built heavy on the front end. Female bears, adult bears, are built heavier on the back end. They have small wrists, small front feet. They don't have to fight. And they look more pie-shaped. And males look more rectangular shaped because they're built so heavy on the front end. Thick necks, thick jaws. And you can, if you get a decent profile of a adult male versus adult female, I mean, you can just tell by the shape of it. I mean, they're bigger on the front, they have big wide front feet, big thick necks, big muzzles, and they're made to fight. Females don't have to fight.
Myron, you and your staff are to be commended. This is such a great success program, a success story of conservation, revitalization of a species. I want to talk just a minute, since we've got your valuable brain, about population and where we are now and kind of what optimal or terminal population needs to look like. We're fortunate not to have a whole lot of nuisance population in the state. Where does it get to, you know, you're doing a wonderful job of increasing consumption, you know, to keep it in check. Talk to us just a bit about that.
Well, I get asked all the time, you know, I tell people that, you know, we think we have around 5,000 to 6,000 black bears in the state. And I get asked all the time, well, you know, how many bears can we have in the state? And with really with bears, it's a different take. Bears are really kind of managed from sociological carrying capacity, not necessarily ecological carrying capacity. Ecological carrying capacity would be the number of bears that the landscape could support. I mean, obviously, with the amount of public land and national forest and everything that we have in Arkansas, Arkansas could sustain a lot more bears than what we have ecologically. Sociologically, we're probably about the threshold. I mean, you know, our bear populations continue to expand into Missouri, into northeast Oklahoma, into southwest Oklahoma, and into the Gulf Coastal Plain, where densities are lower. But, you know, I mean, there's a threshold not too far off in the future when that sociological carrying capacity will be reached, if it hasn't already been. And, you know, that kind of, when a bear shows up on someone's porch eating their dog and cat food, they're not so crazy about having bears around. So, you know, in bad years, drought years, when we do have elevated nuisance complaints and stuff like that, that's really kind of what sets the bar on social tolerance of having the bear program. So I would say we're probably not too far from that right now, especially, you know, with the urban sprawl and everything through northwest Arkansas and around Little Rock and all that. And I mean, we're probably not far from it. Any other questions? I think it would be possible, yeah. Split 4 and 4A almost right down the middle, you know. I mean, to be real honest with you, I'm not really sure if Zone 3 and 4 even kind of would come into play as far as having a season right now. We did have one bear harvested in Columbia County. I was glad to see that. I mean, you know, densities are so low in that part of the world at this time. I think it's going to be a non-event for a few years. You know, whether we continue to keep it open or not, that, you know, that's the commission's decision and all that. But if we did keep it open, I just think it's going to be kind of a non-event. And we might be able to tell her by splitting the zone, we might be able to tailor, you know, the quota for four, depending on how we did it. If where the bears are being harvested now, if we kept that as four and then made a 4A to the west, you know, I think it would allow us to tailor that quota a little bit better, maybe. Thank you very much. Oh, sorry.
One last question. So after the harvest question, mm-hmm. Do you have any good bear recipes?
I tell everybody beef bear tips over rice, man. If you take a bear roast and put it in the micro crock pot and a couple of cans of cream and mushroom soup, oh, for about six, 8 hours, and put it over rice, it's pretty delicious.
Myron, I've been with you the last 3 years and looked at bears like we did. I just want to say from the Game and Fish, thank you for your work. Thank you for Absolutely. Your team. Couldn't be any more professional. And, you know, it's been an honor just for you to be a part of this and to what you've done for our bear program and your team as well.
Thank you very much. I mean, I've had an amazing group of professionals to work with the last couple of decades. And I'm telling you, it's all attributed to the support of those professionals that work with me doing all this. So thank you very much.
Our next staff presentation is Michelle Furr. We'll give an update on the conservation.
Good morning, Commissioners, Director. I wanted to introduce Michelle. I started in this position back in October, and Garrett had already started the process for finding a program coordinator. We have 5 programs across our division and multiple agreements that put millions of dollars in landowners' hands. This program, the Conservation Center program, was an additional new program that was started in January. $3.5 million to deliver habitat and some access to landowners across our state, and she's absolutely taken the program and ran with it, and we're excited to have her on our team and excited to hear her present some of the data that's already happened since January the 2nd.
Hello, everyone, commissioners, director, chairman, everyone, good morning. I am excited to add to all the success stories we've heard this morning. Cohen, you probably don't remember me, but I weighed your squirrels at the Big Squirrel Classic. I didn't know you were such a superstar, so great job on your presentation today. But I am really excited to give this presentation and talk about how many private landowners are so excited about what the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission have to offer for private lands across the state. This program is a big win for our agency and a big win for conservation across the state. See, I think we got a clicker, but okay, good deal. So in the beginning, we knew we wanted all the information for this program to be completely online. We wanted the application, the entire process to be online. So our communications division did an excellent job creating a website that included all the information for this program and included the link for the application portal. They also oversaw multiple videos that correlated with all 9 practices for the Conservation Incentive Program. So if you didn't want to read all the information, you could also watch a video for each practice. I wish I had time today to play the introductory video. It's awesome. Hopefully when I present later on, I'll be able to play that video for everyone to see. If you don't know what the Conservation Incentive Program is, this is a cost share incentive program for habitat management for private landowners across the state. And I just wanted to get that out there just in case you didn't know what the program was. So our communications division and our GIS division did a great job uploading the portal for the Survey 123 application at 8:00 in the morning on January 2nd. That's when this program was open live, and that's a lot of pressure when you have hundreds of people ready to apply for a program, and everything worked out perfectly. And we didn't realize that there was actually hundreds and hundreds of people ready to apply at 8:00 in the morning. And here we are today. So we have over 1,208 applications. If you look at the map on the left, that is all the applications for all 9 practices across the entire state. So this program has touched one corner of the state to the other. The areas where you don't see red dots is mostly national forest and areas of heavy agricultural use. If you look at the table on the left, these are all of our 9 practices and the total applications by each practice. Our top 3 are fire break establishment and prescribed burning, feral hog trapping, upland hardwood, and pine forest management. Those make our over half of the applications. I truly believe this has partly due to all the outreach we've conducted, our agency has conducted, our partners have conducted over the past many years on those subjects. So that might have a little bit to do with the high interest. I have also talked with so many landowners the past few months, and they are super excited about lighting the woods on fire and trapping hogs. So they're pumped. So that's something to be really excited about. Okay, so this is one of the many dashboards that our GIS division has put together for this program. This is what I look at every day. So when a landowner goes onto the website and applies to the program, this is where it lands for me to see all the information. If you look on the far left, pending applications, so this is, you know, all the landowners' information, how many acres they signed up for a particular practice, and I can also see all the attachments they uploaded, like their maps and their management plans. Once they're approved, they move on to the left side here. All these applications are time-stamped by the date and time in which they applied, so that helps meet the requirement of the first come, first serve. If you look at the map in the middle, those are all the applications as well. For this particular practice, we're looking at firebreak establishment and prescribed burning. The red dots are pending applications, and the green dots are approved applications. I can click on any one of those dots and get all the information about that particular landowner, which is really nice. Let's see this here. Okay. If you look at the bottom, these are all the nine practices. I'm able to click on each one of these and see all the information for each practice. So that really organizes things really well for me when I'm reviewing applications. Okay, so instead of showing you the super large table with all nine practices, we're going to break this down by each practice in the order in which we reviewed applications. So first step, Ryan Farney, our feral hog coordinator, reviewed all the feral hog trapping applications. So he knew he needed to review these as quickly as possible because these landowners had a two-part process to receive full 75% reimbursement for buying their hog trap. So we have allocated or awarded just under $700,000 and already paid out just over $500,000. That is a fantastic feat. That's a lot of invoices going through fiscal, and that's a lot of landowners getting paid for that initial part of buying the feral hog trap. The landowner will then trap a pig and then get the full 75% reimbursement. So for me, the first practices I wanted to review was fire break establishment and prescribed burning. So both of these practices included burning and fire break establishment. As we know, January and February are top burn months for most of the year. So we wanted to make sure we approve these applications as quickly as possible. That's why we have already awarded the allotment for both of these practices, and we are already starting to make payments to landowners. So we just reached over $95,000 for the amount paid for prescribed fire and burning and fire break establishment, and we have started making payments on Upland Hardwood and Pine Forest Management. You'll notice that amount paid is a little bit lower, and that's because many of our landowners signed up for timber stand improvement, which that management action doesn't occur until later in the summer. So we were trying to pay all the landowners with one payment, so we're going to wait for them to complete the timber stand improvement before we make that payment. So within the last few weeks, we've shifted our focus to these three practices. So invasive plant control is what I've been reviewing the last few weeks. The reason why we haven't started on the approval process as quickly on this particular practice is because we need things to green up, right? So we can positively ID these invasive species. So here within the next few weeks, I will predict we'll start approving this practice, and within the next few months, we'll reach our allocation for that practice. For bank stabilization, our string.
I have one question about invasive plants. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing much giant salvinia, or is that what most of that is, or is that something else?
It's all over the board. I mean, we gave a list for terrestrial invasives that landowners can choose from and aquatic, and so far there's not many applications that actually duplicate themselves. So it just goes to show you the issues we have with invasive for all sorts of species.
Are y'all seeing much giant salvinia at all?
I have not seen that one quite yet, but I wouldn't be surprised if I ran into it. But our stream habitat program has already reviewed all the applications for bank stabilization and approved 10 landowners, so we will start seeing work on bank stabilization this summer. For public fishing access to private waters, we've received 12 applications on this particular practice. Only two have been qualified, and both of those landowners backed out due to the payment rate not being as high as they would have liked. So this is something we're going to visit here within the next few weeks to determine if we do need to bump the payment rate up for this particular practice to increase the interest. On the horizon, we'll start reviewing wetland applications for these three practices. The management actions for these particular practices won't start until late summer, early fall. So we feel confident within the next few months, once the landowners approve, they have plenty of time to complete those management actions. So For winter flooded rice fields, we would like to see at least 50 more applications for this practice to reach our allotment. And we're gonna have a media push here shortly to get more applications for that particular practice. Back in January, there were many rice farmers determining whether their field was going to be in rice or another crop, so that's probably why we didn't see a larger number of applications. So here's the entire table with all the numbers. I just want to focus down here at the totals at the bottom. We have approved so far 321 applications and awarded just over $1.7 million. Our goal is to reach $3.5 million, and we have paid just over $600,000. And at this pace, and I'll go ahead and say this was last week's numbers, you can look at all the numbers for this program each day, and they're moving forward. This program's not stagnant. It is, I mean, we are moving along at a great pace, and at this pace, we will reach that goal. Because I looked at it last night, and we were already, I think, $720,000 on amount paid. So it's been great. Okay, here's another dashboard that I have to brag about our GIS division developing. So this is based on an app called Quick Capture. You're able to download the app and enter the project number for the applicant and take a picture of their completed management action. So if you look on the far left, you can see a picture that Tyler, one of our private lands biologists, uploaded of a prescribed burn and a fire break. And I'm able to look at all the information, and I can also zoom into this small map on the left and see exactly where that picture was taking place and the property boundaries of that landowner. So this has definitely supported the efficiency in delivering for this program and with a delivery of sending invoices up and getting landowners paid. All right, now some success stories. These are some of my favorite part, and as this program moves along and we get towards the end, I'll have a whole bunch more of these. But if you focus your attention in the center on the map, the landowner surrounded in red, that is Burnett Farms, they signed up for and were approved through the Conservation Incentive Program for prescribed burning, 300 acres of prescribed burning. If you look at the bottom right there, surrounded in green, that's Crooked Creek Ranch, and they were approved for fire breaks under the Conservation Incentive Program and also received assistance through our Private Lands Division staff on a burn on the same day that Burnett Farms burned, and Fred Berry had just got done completing a burn. So that is, you know, over 1,000 acres of habitat management within close proximity one another, which as habitat managers, that's what we're always looking for. And I will say this is more common than I realized at the beginning, but neighbors, family, talk, right? So as once one landowner figured out the program was about to open up, they called their neighbor, they called their family, they all lived down the same road, and they all put in together. And if I was able to show you various maps, you could see it as clear as day. You'll have all these clusters of landowners right next to each other wanting to do great habitat work on their property. Another success story is for feral hog trapping. Each month, the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission is going to recognize a trapper that has the largest trap event and the most hogs trapped for the month. And for February, David Hendricks of Southwest Arkansas trapped 37 hogs at one time. That's a lot of pigs in one trap. And 38 for the entire month. And he received a $100 gift card to help with the cost of the bait and trap maintenance. And these were pictures he uploaded when he applied, and I'm hoping he caught every single one of them. Some habitat achievements that we've had over the past few months is over 1,400 burn acres and over 759 feral hogs removed. Like I said, this program never stops moving. Those numbers are up from last week. I checked last night, we're over 1,000 feral hogs removed, and I'm sure we're over 1,500 acres of burning completed. So that's a great achievement, and hopefully next time when I present on this presentation, most of my presentation will be on habitat achievements. So this will be, I'm going to be very excited to showcase all the habitat achievements that are going to come due to this program. And before I take questions, I do want to make note, I used the Arkansas Game and Fish logo here to showcase that, you know, this is not, you know, this was an agency-wide effort. Every division, I feel like every division of this agency has had part in standing this program up and seeing this program till the end. And I think the testimony of this landowner that contacted one of our private lands biologists is a fantastic example of it. And he didn't even get into the program, but said this was the easiest and most efficient cost share application he's ever submitted. So I think that's a great testimony for our agency. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Great presentation. And anyone, any questions?
I don't have a question, but Michelle.
Oh, all three was like, grab all the same.
I'm sorry. You know, there's an adage in business, if you can't manage what you don't measure. I think you're the epitome of the opposite. You're measuring, and it's just Garrett, all of your staff, mm-hmm. and it's a real compliment to see the accountability in this program, the accessibility for our landowners mm-hmm. around the state. And, you know, we didn't plan this, that our legislative body would be here today to see, but I bet they're proud, being our funding partners that helped sponsor this, to see that it's being administered so judiciously. Thank you.
Thank you.
Michelle, I, again, just compliment you and all of our staff for implementing this new program. And again, legislative body here, thank y'all so much. But overwhelming success with the amount of applicants. How are you ranking everything right now? And just for our listening public, how can they, if they're just now hearing about this, where do they go?
Most definitely. This is first come, first serve this year. And like I said, when you apply, it's time stamped. So you will go in order in which you applied. And we are moving through those applications, you know, first come, first serve. But you can review and read all about the program on our website. And on the, if you just Google Conservation Incentive Program, that'll get you right there. And you can look at our you can watch the videos, and you can also apply online. Survey 123 application, very easy application. And if you happen to have a management plan that you can dump in the Dropbox, that's great. If not, we also have a map of all of our private lands biologists on our website that you can reach out to if you need a site visit. Go ahead. This is private landowners. So this is, you know, someone that owns 20, 40, 100 acres. Yep.
I would like to just follow up with that. Sir, you know, this is the first year that we've ever offered this program. And I can tell you right now, one of the many things that we're proud of about this program is that there's no state anywhere in the country doing anything like this. And so we've very much wanted to prove the concept of you know, identifying landowners that are passionate, that want to do the right thing for the natural resources, giving them the resources and the education, and then getting out of the way and seeing whether we could do that. I think the fact that we're only 90 days, less than 90 days into this program, and we're seeing the kind of results that we are, it gives me a whole lot of confidence that we have proved the concept. Where we go in the next iteration of the Conservation Incentive Program, I think when we move beyond the prove the concept phase, that's where we'll begin to see things like prioritizing landowners closer to public lands, prioritizing, you know, landowners that can maybe replicate what other states are doing around giving giving the public access to their private lands. So we're very much in prove the concept mode right now. Garrick, Michelle, Randy, everybody in Private Lands Division, y'all are knocking it out of the park. It'll be how we mature this in the out years that will let us draw a shorter connection between public lands and this private lands management.
Any other questions? Great report. Thank you,
Thank
Michelle.
You.
Very good. And now Director Booth will deliver the director's report.
Oh, that went the wrong way. All right, good morning, everybody. I'm Austin Booth, the director of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, and it's good to be in Mount Magazine again, but certainly good to be here as a commission. Since I've been the director, I made a list over there. We've been to Monticello, Magnolia, Rogers, Fort Smith, Texarkana, Ponca, Jonesboro twice, Mountain Home, and now Mount Magazine. The reason we do that is the exact same reason we sent invitations out today. It's the exact same reason that we've worked really hard this year to get public input on our regulations process. And like we covered yesterday, we have well over 40,000 responses. It is that the most important part of conservation is people, all right? It would be really easy to just keep our eye laser focused on the natural resource and only manage the natural resource, but that's called preservation, not conservation. And the reason that we want to get out on the road and in communities is because we not only recognize that you know and love your communities more than we do, but also because you matter. You matter to this agency, and that's why we've had such an amazing time here. So in that vein about regs and where we stand with the regs process, I have just a tremendous amount of confidence about the future of conservation in Arkansas based on exactly that, the quality of the people that care deeply about it. We can look no further than the fact that we've already discussed deer hunting, both behind dogs or in a tree stand this morning. We should be fortunate and count ourselves blessed to live in a state where that's what we're debating, not whether hunting is appropriate, not whether the use of dogs at all is appropriate. That is a blessing in and of itself in Arkansas, where the fact that hunting is a important part of our culture and our heritage, that it is a given. We can also look at the fact that we have supporters in the legislature that are here today, Representative Eubanks, Senator Rice. We hate the Representative Wardlaw, couldn't be here today, but had to go to a funeral down in Louisiana. This conservation incentive program, this notion of giving private landowners that are just as passionate about the natural resources as we are, the resources and the education, and then getting out of the way, that would not be possible if it were not for our legislature and our governor. So we're incredibly grateful for them as well. I also want to thank Jessica Feltz, Corey Gray, and the entire research team. You know, we have over 40,000 responses to our regs public survey, and we're currently coming through not only those 40,000 responses, but the 100,000 comments. I also want to thank Myron Means. One of the commissioners mentioned it this morning, but we recently wrapped up our 2024 Bear Den trips. All right, those are always such a fantastic time, but there is an unbelievable amount of work that goes into it for all the families, for all the citizens that get to go out there on Saturday or Sunday morning to meet a bear up close, live in person for the first time. That's a Saturday or Sunday that Myron or AJ or Dr. Ballard or anybody else on the bear team is leaving their family at home. So we want to thank them for the year-round work that they do for the bear for the bear resource, but also for the amount of work and sometimes danger that goes into working with bears this time of year. Lastly, I want to recognize Cohen's parents. All right, y'all are the true heroes here today. All right. Cohen, we certainly want to celebrate your love for the outdoors, and that is awesome. All right, you're an example, young man, of what many adults in this room need to be like. All right, and I can promise you, if more people had the kind of heart and attitude and excitement and love for the outdoors that you do, everybody's job here would be a lot easier. All right, so thank you, Cohen. But yeah, as a parent to a 10-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 5-year-old, there's nobody up here that can say enough about how important what y'all are doing is. All right, when we look high and low throughout Arkansas, when we try to approach education and we see, you know, broad decline in the numbers of hunters, both old and young, in Arkansas and throughout the country, it's oftentimes not for lack of interest, right? It's for lack of people like y'all that are willing to put in the sweat equity, the resources, the time, the focus, the attention, the mentorship, all of that that it takes to make a fine young man just like y'all are doing. So thank y'all. Y'all are the true heroes here today. All right. Lastly, just want to recognize that Representative Matt Duffield's here. Sorry that I left you out, sir. Really grateful to see the public come out and support these meetings. We are about halfway through our regs process today. However, there's not final adoption of any regs until May. So me, the commissioners, and our staff will certainly be around after this meeting for any kind of input that y'all want to share.
Thank you, Director Booth. All right, at this time, we need to get into our committee reports, and committee chairs will deliver the reports from Wednesday's committee meetings. First up, Commissioner Finley, Vice Chair of the Regulations Committee, will give that report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our committee met yesterday. Commissioner Ann Marie Ramos could not make it today, so I'm stepping in for her to fill her big shoes. Discussion items we shared yesterday in the Regulations Committee. Jessica Feltz delivered an update to the Commission on the 2024 Regulations Public Input Survey. This was a high-level preliminary overview, and the results for a more in-depth review will be held in the April meeting. Nick Goforthen gave an overview and an update of the Wildlife Diversity and State Wildlife Grants Program. He went over the Arkansas Wildlife Action Plan, federal funding models, and research being conducted by staff and partners. Our action items included Chief Tommy Laird presented the first reading of two fishery regulations proposals. The committee gave a unanimous due pass. In new business, the committee was asked the staff to create appropriate, draft code language to summarize materials for three regulations that will be added to the 2024 regulation proposal package. The proposal regulations will receive an official reading in the April 10-11 2024 commission meeting and include allowing motion decoys for waterfowl hunting on wildlife management areas, the addition of a 4-day non-resident fishing license product, and allowing weapons capable of firing straight-walled ammunition statewide all muzzleloader seasons. Certain weapon restrictions will apply. The committee gave a unanimous due pass on those items as well. There was no old business and we were adjourned.
Thank you, Commissioner Finley. Again, Commissioner Finley, Chair of the Property Management Committee.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. Our Property Management Committee met. We had two action items. Colonel Brad Young presented a minute order requesting the inventory removal for the award and the award of service weapon to retiring law enforcement corporal John Partain, to which the committee gave unanimous due pass. Brad Young also presented a minute order requesting the removal and award of the sale of a service weapon to retiring law enforcement corporal Louis Smith. Again, the committee gave unanimous due pass. There was no new business, no old business, and we were adjourned.
Thank you, Commissioner Finley. Next is Commissioner Bill Jones, Chair of the Education ITGIS Communications Committee.
Thank you, Chairman. The Education Committee met, and there were discussion items. First, we had Amy Swan give an update on the Archery in the Schools program following the state tournament earlier this month. Jimmy Self updated the commission on the youth shooting sports program in effort to increase participation. Also, Davidson updated the commission on fishing in the natural state program and its effort in schools across the state. Spencer Griffin and staff from PAYET updated the commission on progress made with the licensing system since January in anticipation of the upcoming turkey season. So we're hoping that's gonna do well. There were no action items. There were no new business. No old business, and we return.
Thank you, Commissioner Jones. Next is the Budget Committee, Commissioner J.D. Neely.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Budget Committee was called to order. We had one discussion item. Emily Shumay presented us the agency's financial status report. It's a great report. And we had no action items, no new business, no old business, and we were adjourned.
Thank you, Commissioner Neely. Last is Commissioner Tappan, Chair of the Personnel Governance Committee.
Yes, sir, Chairman. Our committee meeting was held yesterday. We had one discussion item. Mr. Jim Goodhart delivered the agency's legal report. There were no action items, no new business, and no old business. We did get a special announcement that General Counsel Jim Goodhart would be retiring June 30th. And it's certainly a little early to recognize him, but with all the years of service that he has contributed to this commission, it's worth recognizing for the next successive months, thanks to his great service.
Thank you, Commissioner Tappan. Now the business items being brought before the commission. Item 6A is the first reading of the fisheries additional regulation clarifications. Fisheries Chief Tom Laird, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Director, Commissioners. Chairman, I bring for you two proposals today, as I mentioned yesterday. The first one is Lake Conway. Everyone knows it's under renovation. Back in July, we passed an emergency proclamation. This regulation today will remove the bag limit indefinitely until that renovation is done. The second regulation proposal has to do with Lake Pickthorn. Bass limit in 2018, we passed a regulation by the commission. I'm here for clarification on that. The signage on the lake's correct, the guidebook's correct, but the verbiage in the code book is wrong. And we're wanting to bring all three of those in line. I'll remind you, this is the first reading. And with that, I'll take any questions you may have.
This is a first reading. No action is required. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Item 6B is request for the inventory removal award and sale of the service weapon of Corporal John Pertain. Colonel Brad Young, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Commissioners. Director Booth, coming for you this morning, two inventory removal items for the award and sale. The first one is Corporal John Pertain with 37 years of service. And the second is Corporal Andy Smith with 28 years of service. Appreciate a good vote.
This item requires the approval of the Property Management Committee. Commissioner Finley, was this approved by the Property Management Committee?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, both receiving do pass.
I have a motion to approve the request. No second is necessary. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion is approved.
Thank you, sir.
Next is item 6B, a request for the inventory removal award. Sell. Brad, did you do both of those at the same time?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I've done both of those at the same time. All right, are there any new business at this time? Any old business? Commissioner Tappan, no need for executive session?
No, Chairman Jones, there is no need for an executive session.
Okay, that concludes our business part of this. When we come to the end of what we're doing, I usually ask the commissioners if they have something they want to say or a question they want to ask. And I'll start on the end down there with Commissioner Michelle Evans-White.
Thank you, Commissioner, Chairman, for always letting me go first. It's hard.
Yes, you would.
All right. It's always easier to go first than last. I was really touched by hearing Cohen's story and seeing all the impact that our education division's having. And just want to say how grateful I am to be part of an organization where people are so supportive of youth and kids' education. And it's not just in the education division. Went and saw Bear Den visit on Sunday. And saw all the staff that were so good with the kids, letting them see the mama bear and hear the heartbeat. It's just great to be in an organization with that culture, so thank you.
Commissioner Bill Jones.
Enjoyed this. This is on my bucket list. My wife and I have been wanting to come up here for a long time, and what a beautiful part of the country y'all have here. It's unbelievable. I have realized one thing, that I'm a better bass fisherman than a crappie fisherman. Chairman Jones and I would not have filled up a frying pan yesterday, but I think the other commissioners did a pretty good job. One thing I do want to say about the dog hunters. I grew up dog hunting in Hamburg, Arkansas. I understand it. It's in your blood, and we totally understand it and get it. We get it, both sides of it. So one thing I would ask you all, and it was touched on a bit today, is we know where all the problems are. We know the problem landowners, what they want. We know the dog hunters, what you want. What I would like to hear in the next few weeks from you all is a solution that you all think you can live with, the solution that the entire state can live with, because with that we can go forward and make everybody happy. So this is what I suggest to you.
Commissioner Finley.
I'm up. Well, first of all, it's been a great time coming here. First time on Mount Magazine. I absolutely love it. As an aviator, this is the one place in the world that every aviator in Arkansas knows. It's the tallest point in the state. That being said, coming in the other day, you see the beauty of spring. It's just around the corner, which is great for all of us, those turkey hunters as well. You see a number of fires burning throughout our state, which is very positive. As inconvenient as it could be at times, it's extremely positive to think of the habitat improvements we're making around the state and seeing folks being involved. And so just continue to encourage folks to realize when you see that, great things are behind it.
Thank you. Let's go down to Commissioner Tappan.
Chairman, I echo what my fellow commissioners have said about this great venue. I compliment the state representatives, our senator, for funding this many years ago and continuing the high-class operations of these state parks facilities. They're so integral to our outdoor embracement of our state, whether they be residents or non-residents. And boy, this is a milestone, a keystone property to show that. So thank you. Chairman Jones, thanks to you for putting on extracurricular activities and hosting us. And I thank all the staff for all your work in organizing a great event. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Neely.
Well, a lot of fun has been had up here, and certainly this is a flagship of our state parks up here, and it's been a wonderful visit to Mount Magazine. And I was up here originally with an AFA meeting, Arkansas Forestry Association meeting, I think about the first month this place opened up, and that was a long time ago. And it's certainly continued the beauty of it, and getting to be up here on the mountain has been a blessing every time I get to come up here. Myron did a great presentation on the bear hunt, and I couldn't help but just note, with all the pictures we got to see Cohen in, he's killed just about everything that the state has to offer. I bet it's not far that we see Cohen posing with a bear harvest. Don't y'all think? He'll have an archery bear tag at some point, and those two are destined to come together. Again, Cohen, congratulations on all of your early successes. And I might add, if y'all noted, a lot of those were public land opportunities that y'all are participating in. And so again, we've got a lot of great public land, and this area is rich in opportunity in affording all of our Kansans a great place to come. The fishing yesterday, you know, Bill and Stan, I'm sorry y'all got skunked on your end, and Tappan and I on our end.
You ain't caught a few fish.
Tappan and I down here, kind of were shining. That's all is the way I remember the scorecard. But We did have a fun time on Blue Mountain Lake, my first time to get to ever fish on that, and certainly hope it's not the last. And I think we are taking away quite a few crappie fillets out of that lake from our side of the boat. Anyway, again, a great time. Thanks again to all of the folks that showed up today, all of the audience here that are passionate about the dogs. We will, as has been said, we will take everything into consideration and look at all aspects of this and how it impacts us. Again, a great trip. And echo what Phil said, Mr. Chairman, thank you for organizing all of this and picking this great spot.
Thank you,
Commissioner. Before you get into that, Chairman Jones, I just have to add one thing. I'd be remiss if I didn't back up my partner here in this tremendous crappie tournament, the crappie champion of the world tournament, for those who didn't know, sanctioned and on ESPN last night on the 1:30 broadcast. But we have actually put out, and the reason Jessica Phelps is not here, she's currently crafting a survey for the state to determine can you count the largest fish if your guide caught the fish? And that's going to go around the state. Of course, we'd ask each of you guys and ladies to participate in that. We'd like to see about 60,000 people.
We certainly helped net the thing anyway.
There is a question about that. We'll get to that later.
You know, I'm going to give you a chance to talk in just a second, but I've got to quickly respond to that. You know, we plainly said we'd be back at 5 o'clock, and as far as I know, Bill and I were the only two that were there at the dock at 5 o'clock. Everybody else was pretty well disqualified because you didn't get there at 5 o'clock. So the zero fish that me and Bill caught actually won because y'all didn't meet the qualifications, whether it's in the Olympics or anything. 5 o'clock is 5 o'clock, and y'all didn't make it there.
But our guide caught one, so that doesn't
count. Yeah, guide did catch one. Director Booth, closing remarks.
Just want to thank everybody again for a great week in Mountain Magazine. I hope to be back soon.
I got a couple things I want to say here in closing. And Director Booth said conservation in Arkansas whenever he was giving his report. Zing, X-I-N-G, was our guide yesterday, and he was from Taiwan. And he was talking. He said, "You guys don't know what it's like." This is a 45-year-old man that's been here a long time. And he said, "You know, y'all have a lot of stuff. I fish on beaver and hunt and do a lot of things." He said, "Y'all have a lot of stuff in Arkansas." He said, "In Taiwan, we don't have this. All of the animals have been hunted and killed. There's no fish." He said, "The people, so many people there, they have just ravaged the country, and there's nothing there to do." So yes, it's awesome that we have a place that we can regulate. And again, when I was a boy, if I just saw a deer track, it was something. So now it's way farther along. Michelle, on what you talked about and what you did, a couple of things in my closing remarks is there's an actual thing, I don't know what it's called, but you know, I have figured it out. I like statistics, and you know, I would go to work for someone for a penny a day if you'll double it every day and let me work 1 month. It's either $5 or $7 million you'd be paying me at the end of the month. First day you give me a penny, second day you give me 2 cents, third day you give me 4 cents. If you work that math out, in 31 days it'll be $5 or $7 million. I can't remember the exact amount. Same thing with these hogs. Same correlation with these hogs. We have a problem in Arkansas. I'm a farmer. I have a farm. They tear my farm up. They destroy. We kill 80, 90, 100. We trap about that many as we can. But these hogs are something that we have to deal with. We have to. You know, I don't know that they multiply quite as fast as a penny a day, double it, and what that will do, but it's similar. That's how this thing takes off. And we need to do everything that we can to do that. And I want to say the dog hunters, you know, we are understanding and hearing. It was important for y'all to be here today, for y'all to give your testimonies, and for the senator and representatives to talk and to say what they did, and for Jan Jones to give yours. And like Commissioner said, if you got something input that you could give us a solution, that something that's workable, that helps us, we're going to look at this and talk about it and try to make a good decision on that. Cohen, on your dad has a big responsibility. You've done a good job. It's for a father to teach a kid to go out and do the right thing. Do the right thing. Live by the law. Always do the right thing. It's a big responsibility. You come to a point to where that you become a good hunter, and it's not anything to go out there and kill a deer. Always do the regulations. Always do what the law says. Be a outstanding young man. Dad, be a good teacher. Teach your son to hunt the correct way. Instill in him a value system that he will carry with him until he's 75, 80 years old. Let him continue to be the example that you want him to be, teaching good ways to do this. With that, I think, yes.
Representative Richmond sent a text message. He would like to have been here. He had a kidney stone problem.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. And we appreciate it. It means a lot for y'all to be here. This is y'all's area, and we're glad to come and be a part of it and understand it better. And with no further ado, I'll call this meeting to adjourn.